Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. It's a joy to welcome you to worship today. We have a special event today in the worship service where we'll be recognizing and welcoming our second graders into the Bible reading life of our church, and that will appear right after the Gloria and before the prayer of illumination. I'd like to invite you to take the red pee pads and pass them down and greet your neighbors as the pad is passed back by, and greet them after the service, helping us share the love of Jesus Christ together and helping us know our guests as they worship with us. I'm going to say one good thing about next Sunday. Next Sunday, one of my very good friends, John McCall, will be with us. John is a PCUSA missionary on the island of Taiwan, and we have supported him for several years in his ministry there. And part of your five-year capital campaign that broke ground and started work on the fellowship hall was a 10% pledge to missions. And part of that mission effort was paid as a $12,000 gift to the Taiwan Seminary where John works to help fund a new roof. The roof on the dormitory was so bad that water had come in for so long that the walls of the dorm rooms were covered in mold. Yes, come study here where you can sleep beside mold-infested walls. They were exceedingly pleased to know of our gift, and John will give us an update on that when he's here next week. During the Sunday school hour, he has a presentation and some slides to show about his work in Taiwan and the church and its growth in Taiwan, particularly among indigenous Taiwanese. So he's my friend, and I want you to know him, and I hope you'll come next Sunday. He's a great speaker, a good pastor, and a terrific missionary for Jesus Christ. Another worker for Jesus Christ that I call a good friend is Sam Boger. Sam.
I volunteer in the church office on Thursdays. I edit, proofread, and fold the bulletins and the announcement sheets, so I'm always on the lookout for typos. And I'm embarrassed to say it looks like I missed one in today's bulletin. If you look on the second page where it says Godful lesson, that should read Gospel lesson. I found other typos recently, not in the bulletin, but elsewhere. I live in Oak Valley. Back in March, they had signs all over the neighborhood telling you about an Easter egg on Sundary, March 25th. And in the Winston-Salem Journal, there was a letter to the editor. There was a time when America built hydroelectric dams, D-A-M-N. Those are typos. And speaking of typos, we need typos, type A's, type B's, and type A's. Have a club ride on Thursday. Note to self, wait for grown and bad pun tonight. We do have a blood drive this Thursday from 2:30 to 7 in the fellowship hall. The sign-up sheet on the bulletin board outside choir. If you look at the sign-up sheet, you'll notice there are two ways to donate, WB, or whole blood, meaning you simply fill up a bag and you're done. It takes about 20 minutes once you're in the chair. The second way is 2 RBC, or double red blood cells. Instead of going into a bag, your blood goes into a machine which extracts your red blood cells and puts the plasma and other blood components back into you. This takes about 45 minutes, but it counts as 2 units towards our goal of 51. Our church is one of the biggest producers in the region. We collected 298 pints last year, and we've become a victim of our own success. For double reds, we used to have 4 appointment slots and 1 machine. Starting this drive, we will have 8 slots and 2 machines. But right now, we're in pretty good shape. All our whole blood appointments are filled, and 7 of the 8 double reds are filled. It's peak strawberry season, and Bobby Klutz has told me he might try to work that into his pastries and baked goods that he provides to donors. And anyone who donates at our drive will be entered into a drawing to win one of 3 $1,000 Home Depot gift cards. Okay, I'll sit down now. You have been punished.
He is a hard act to follow. Please join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. Sing to the Lord a new song.
God is a marvelous thing.
God remembers his steadfast love and faithfulness.
Thank you.
here in a few weeks. On Pentecost Sunday, we'll also be having Confirmation Sunday. Our confirmation students are 8th graders who've been working for many long weeks now, and one of the things that we really talk about a lot is what I call the R word. I can see you're searching your memory banks. What is the R word? Relationships. And when we think about our relationship with God and the good world that God made, sin is something that damages our relationships with God and with each other. And so with honest hearts, I invite you to pray with me the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. Life-giving God, we hear the harmony of your grace and love in our souls, but so often our responses are off-key. We want to learn your songs of truth and love, but haunting tunes of our past mistakes are stuck in our heads. The pain we have caused others and ourselves silences our voices. Sing to us your song of forgiveness, hope, and love. Surround us with mercy, that we may sing along and share. Heal our discordant hearts and hear our prayers. Friends, hear the good news. No matter where we go, no matter what we do, nothing can separate us from the love of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in Jesus' holy name that I declare we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
You're in school, and your reading has become part of your daily life. You're getting old enough to read the Bible and talk about it with your families and your friends and your teachers and the church, and to learn from the Bible what it means to live as children of God. The Bibles you are about to receive are a gift from Clemens Presbyterian Church. These Bibles are yours to read, to use, and to mark up, and to keep. Our confirmands are using the Bibles that they got when they were in second grade. So you will use them here and you will use them in your homes and out in the world. So, and this is the word of the Lord. Caleb, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sarah, this is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious God, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Bless these Bibles, those who give them and the children who receive them. Speak your word to them so that they may know the promise of your love, trust the goodness of your grace, follow the way that leads from darkness into light, and live as your children, now and forever. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray.
Eternal God, clear our ears and hearts that your words may bring truth to Scripture and worship this hour and all their lives. Amen. This morning's Old Testament lesson is Psalm 98. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness, and the peoples with equity. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Near the end of his life, near the end of his public ministry, he shared these words with his disciples. Listen to the word of the Lord. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I've heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It's time for children time. Patrick.
Our children, please come down front. We've got something exciting to share. Thinking about another exciting Sunday, which is coming. It's going to be in 2 weeks. It's a special day called Pentecost. I'm not sure if you've heard of that before, but we do get to celebrate it every year, and that's the birthday of the church. Can you imagine such a thing? Birthday of the church. Pentecost is when Jesus founded the church. He sent his Spirit, which came. So because of that, we all get to be here. Look at all these people. We all get to be here together, and you get to be here, and it's because we all love Jesus. And I think that's a very exciting thing. And when we talk about loving Jesus, one thing that Pastor Bill just read was that we love Jesus by loving other people. We love Jesus by loving other people. And one way we can love other people is through something 2 weeks from now called the Pentecost Special Offering. We're going to gather up money, gifts together, and we're going to give those so that we can help other people. We can love Jesus by loving other people. These offerings will be used to help something called the Young Adult Volunteers Program. These are people who go and live for an entire year together. Spend a whole year loving Jesus, and we've had at least two of them here. Kelly Norris, 3. Jennifer Ring, we've had 3 people. So this money will help support them as they love Jesus, and the rest of the money goes for supporting children who are at risk, various youth programs around the world. So this is focused on young people. And so I have something that I've printed off here for you. I have one helper, please. One helper. Yes, thank you. I'm going to keep one. And if you pass one of those out to everybody, this is a word search and it's a crossword puzzle. And I want you to go home and do this with your family so you all can get in the spirit to celebrate the church's birthday. This is something fun you all can do. And talk about loving Jesus together as a family. So as she finishes passing those out, we are going to close in prayer. Thank you so very much for your help. Let's pray together, friends. Dear God, thank you for loving us the way you do, and thank you for blessing us with this church family so that we can be together, we can worship God, and that we can love the world as we know you want us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
friends up north. I do. And I like to send them pictures. Particularly crocus coming up in the yard, green grass, flowers blooming, when I know their snow blowers are still running, when they're shoveling and breaking ice off their windshields. They're frozen. They're just frozen. Some of you may remember the oil embargo of the 1970s, when our government tried to convince us that saving oil was helping our country. We were better citizens when we helped America save energy, we were told. The believing of patriotism impacted the doing of saving energy. Believing and doing. Foreign countries tried to exert their will on Americans, and America responded. Believing and doing. In the passage today, Jesus is trying to share his will and his message of love with the disciples here before his arrest and execution. It's like a deadline. He knows this is a time-limited event. And he'll not be able to teach them anymore. So he's got to get this message in and pound it home to them. Can you imagine how much he wanted to share with them? To remind them of, to reinforce to them? You teachers, it's like right before those big exams. You've got to get that in. You've got to get that in. When I was a senior in high school, the one math teacher in Maiden High had a nervous breakdown like the second week of class. I claimed no responsibility. There were like 8 students in the senior math class, and she was going to, the word was she'd be back in a couple weeks, and she wasn't. Then she'd be back at Thanksgiving, and she wasn't. Then she'd be back before Christmas. And that went on until the last week of school, when she came back and sought to teach the year of advanced, of senior math in a week. And I took a seat on the front row. I mean, I was going to college. I need to know this stuff. And I took notes furiously and asked questions. And on about Wednesday or maybe Thursday, she gathered up all the chalkboard erasers and carried them over and put them on my desk. And she said, "Mr. Hoyle, if you'll go clean these chalkboard erasers, we'll all be doing something important." She had stuff to communicate, and my questions were not helping her get her stuff accomplished. Now, why can't I read the church anything? Why don't I ever follow math stuff? Does it go back to Mrs. Sloop? I don't know. But anyway, she had a lot to get in. Jesus had a lot to get in to his disciples, and he thought it was really important to reinforce the message and the message of love one another was what he thought was most critical for them moving forward. Jesus, as he says, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you." That's the connection. In a few weeks, we'll be celebrating Trinity Sunday, which is on my calendar, one of the high holy days of the church year when we have to preach on the Trinity, and it's the most exciting year of, it's not. I endure Trinity Sunday because it's so hard to understand and almost impossible to break apart in an 18-minute sermon. But the connection of love between God and Jesus, that is what Jesus says is the connection between his disciples and him. The same thing. If we want to be connected to God, as God is connected within the Trinity, love is the only element of that connection. We could say the vital connection, the essential connection, is love. Love is what binds them together and binds us to God. Jesus is not describing a feeling of love with the Father or with us, as much as he's focused on an active and connectional love. In the Gospels, God is always communicating with Jesus, and Jesus is always in an active and connectional relationship with God. God is empowering Jesus. Jesus' disciples can adore or admire or fawn over or appreciate Jesus as much as they like. I don't think he really cared. What he cared about was this statement that he makes here. Love one another. Love me. Do something. Do something. As the Father has loved me, so I love you. Do something. And what does he say to do? He says, abide in my love. It's an action, he says, to take. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. So how do you do that, this abiding business? He says, if you keep my commandments, you are abiding. Okay, so we have commandments. We all think of the Big Ten, or as Burl Shore used to say, the Big Ten suggestions. The Big Ten commandments, is that what Jesus is about? No. I don't think he was against the Ten Commandments, but he says there's one commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. Have you ever heard the saying, easier said than done? Does that ever apply in your life, easier said than done? Love one another. So here's a question. Which is tougher? When Jesus says to pray, saying, forgive us as we forgive others, easy? Sure. Gosh, I hope not. Gosh, I hope God is so much more forgiving than I am. Or Jesus' line here, love one another as I have loved you. Or could both be equally difficult. Love one another. Love one another. The people with whom you don't agree about anything, love one another. The people who seem to want to get under your skin, love one another. The people who just seem to take pleasure in making you miserable, love one another. Except them? They're not any accepts. Love one another. Let me me to go on. I could keep going. But every line you make, the answer is love one another. And he's not talking about the Hallmark card love. He's not talking about the, I'll avoid them so we won't get into it. Avoidance, action, love. Here's the way Jesus put it. You did not choose me. I chose you, and I chose you to bear fruit. I chose you because you have work to do. We have work to do. When the boss is choosing workers, it matters not at all if the picker is nice or well-dressed or is having a good hair day. Workers are chosen because the job needs to be done. God chose you because there is fruit that needs to be picked. And it's fruit that you are primed to pick. That maybe you are the best person to bear that fruit. And God has chosen you. There are lessons that need to be taught and truth that needs to be told and people that need to be loved and cared for, prayers that need to be prayed and songs that need to be sung. Bearing fruit, abiding in God's love is what is often, it's hard sometimes. This is an unloving world. And there are some people that are difficult to love. It is not an easy thing. In fact, it's a hard thing. Sometimes it takes concentration and focus and work and struggle and communion with God and sweat to bear the good fruit. There you go. That is why the chosen cannot be frozen. No matter how cold it is, when people are working hard, when they are bearing good fruit, when they are loving the unlovely, when they're making the effort to obey and follow the one who chose us, they're sweating. They're working hard. It's hard work. For if we are to reset the world so that it might be seen as godly, if we are to reset the world so that the world might see him in it and maybe might see him in us, then we have to be busy. We have to be busy about it. We have to be intentional about bearing that fruit. Love one another as I have loved you. Not just loving in thought, but loving in deed and working much too hard to be frozen. Join me as we stand together and say what we believe using the Creed of the Council of Nicaea. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light,
true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, and has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. We are blessed through the love of God with this beautiful world and the opportunities to worship and sing God praises, and also the opportunities to serve and minister in God's name. Some of you saw this past week on our Facebook page a picture of the CPC volunteers at the Samaritan Inn, and I was so proud to see them witnessing for Jesus Christ through the serving of meals and providing shelter for homeless men in Winston-Salem. These are the sorts of ministries that your giving supports, and we thank you for sharing of your tithes and offerings. Thank you. us in so many ways. Through your love and goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and the service of your kingdom. Amen. Please be seated.
Friends, if you turn your attention to the blue announcement sheet, commend each of these items to you, and especially extend a warm welcome up to the atrium after service, where we'll have coffee and cookies and a great time of fellowship that is made possible today by the elders who are currently serving on the session. So thanks to them, and thanks to you also for being there so we can be together. Also, we have a call for all the men of the church. Next weekend is Mother's Day, and we could really use your help, and more specifically, your voice. We would love to have you sing with us so we can celebrate the mothers and women in general that day. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the Lord right here at this table. People will come from north and south, east and west, sit at the Lord's table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when the risen Lord was with his disciples, they were together, and he took bread and he broke it. And in that moment, their eyes were opened and recognized him. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites those who trust him to share in this feast that he himself has prepared for us. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Loving God, it is right and our great joy to give you thanks and praise, for you have created this universe. At your word, the earth was made and set spinning on its course amongst the stars. Your hand formed us from the dust of the earth, and you set us amongst all of your creatures to love serve you. When we were unfaithful to you, you kept faith with us. Your love remained steadfast. When we were slaves in Egypt, you freed us. You led us through the desert with a pillar of fire, leading us into the promised land for which you had prepared. In time, you sent prophets to speak your good news to us, to speak your word of love and justice, and to prepare us for the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ. When he came with healing in his touch, and he was wounded for our sins. When he came with mercy in his voice, and he was mocked as one despised. When he came with peace in his heart, and he met with violence and death. By your power, O God, Jesus was broken free from the prison of his tomb, and at his command, the gates of hell themselves were opened. The one who was dead now lives. The one who humbled himself is raised to rule over all creation. O God, remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine from the gifts you have given us. Celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Nourished at this table, O God, we pray that we would know Christ's redemptive love and live a new life in him. We pray that you would keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all of your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Praying to you, the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we offer these our prayers and seal them by praying together that which Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as
disciples, and after supper he took bread and blessed it and broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after the meal, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again in glory. These are the gifts of God for the people.
Body of Christ broken for you. Power of the Holy Spirit, the cup of salvation.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament and united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. We thank you for your love for us, that you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Today we pray for all your people, particularly your people seeking peace and security. We pray for the abatement of nuclear threats in the Koreans. We pray for peace around this your world, in the Sudan and South Sudan, in Chicago, in Clemens, and all the places where we know and live and people whom we love. Lord, we pray for peace. Hear us as we pray for those who need to be filled with your healing touch and the comforting presence of your Holy Spirit in their final days. We pray for Patty Levering and for so many others who are in need of your care. You call us as your children, and when we sing your praises with joy, and when our souls are wounded, we turn to you. We bring our prayers and concerns, our woundedness, our confusion to you, O God. For you have the words of eternal life, those words of comfort and peace for which we long. We're filled with thanksgiving and praise for your work in the lives of our young people. These days when so many are walking with caps and gowns and receiving diplomas and certificates, we are filled with joy along with the graduates and their parents. Gracious God, continue to be their guide. Show them your way in all the ways they go. Show them that they have a place in your kingdom, and that their love for others is an expression of your love for all. Give them strength and courage to face the new days and new ways. Lord, we pray for our church. We pray for our session. We pray for all those in authority over us, in our government, and in this your world. Hear our prayers for our persons in service in the military and the police, and in so many ways that you look out for us and guide our steps toward peace. Guide our steps as we work for your coming kingdom and all that it means. Guide our words as we speak out for what is right. Open our hearts to the truth of your love and acceptance and compassion, that we might be your presence in this world that you share with us. Let this be so, in Christ's name. Amen.